everyone. I'm back here with my today's episode of Wow. Wow, that is words of wisdom. And today we are remembering Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, a favorite of many of you I know, and mine definitely. So let us see a little about Abdul Kalam. Abul Pakir Jainulabdin Abdul Kalam was an Indian aerospace scientist and politician who served as the 11th President of India from 2002 to 2007. He was born and raised in Rameswaram, Tamil Nadu, and studied physics and aerospace engineering. He spent the next four decades as a scientist and science administrator, mainly at the Defense Research and Development Organization, that is the DRDO, and Indian Space Research Organization, that is ISRO, and was intimately involved in India's civilian space program and military missile development efforts. He thus came to be known as the Missile Man of India for his work and on the development of ballistic missile and launch vehicle technology. He also played a pivotal organizational and technical and political role in India's Pokhran 2 nuclear tests in 1998, the first since the original nuclear test by India in 1974. So we can see a beautiful picture of Abdul Kalam's childhood. His parents are here, and yes, his sister and a brother. And I'll tell you more about his family. Abul Pakir Jainulabdin Abdul Kalam was born on 15th of October 1931 to a Tamil Muslim family in the pilgrimage center of Rameswaram on Pamban Island, then in the Madras Presidency and now in the state of Tamil Nadu. His father, Jainulabdin, was a boat owner and imam of a local mosque. His mother, Ashyama, was a housewife. His father owned a ferry, that is a small boat, that took Hindu pilgrims back and forth between Rameswaram and now uninhabited Dhanushkodi. Kalam was the youngest of four brothers and one sister in his family. Kalam was elected as the 11th President of India in 2002 with the support of both the ruling Bharatiya Janata Party and then opposition Indian National Congress. Widely referred to as the People's President, he returned to his civilian life of education, writing, and public service after a single term. He was recipient of several prestigious awards, including the Bharat Ratna, India's highest civilian honor. In the picture, we can see him taking oath when he became the President of India in 2002. Here is a wonderful picture of Vladimir Putin and Barack Obama with Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. Both of them regarded and respected Abdul Kalam a lot. While delivering a lecture at the Indian Institute of Management, IIM, Shillong, Kalam collapsed and died from an apparent cardiac arrest on 27th of July 2015 when he was only 83. There are people who live more, but he died at the age of 83. Thousands, including national level dignitaries, attended the funeral ceremony held in his hometown of Rameswaram, where he was buried with full state honors. Now comes the speech that I was talking about, the iconic speech, My Vision for India. Let's hear. On the 5th of May 2011 in IIT Hyderabad, that is in Sangareddy district of Telangana, India, Here he gave this speech. He said, I have three visions for India. In 3,000 years of our history, people from all over the world have come and invaded us, captured our lands, conquered our minds. From Alexander onwards, the Greeks, the Turks, the Mughals, the Portuguese, the British, the French, the Dutch, all of them came and looted us, took over what was ours. Yet, we have not done this to any other nation. We have not conquered anyone. We have not grabbed their land, their culture, their history, and tried to enforce our way of life on them. Why? Because we respect the freedom of others. That is why my first vision is that of freedom. I believe that India got its first vision of this in 1857 when we started the War of Independence. It is this freedom that we must protect and nurture and build on. If we are not free, no one will respect us. We have 10% growth rate in most areas. Our poverty levels are falling. Our achievements are being globally recognized today. Yet, we lack the self-confidence. We see ourselves as a developed nation, self-reliant and self-assured. Isn't this incorrect? Why do we lack this self-confidence? Why do we lack to believe that we are self-reliant, we are self-assured, we are a developed nation? My second vision for India is development. For 50 years, we have been a developing nation. It is time we see ourselves as a developed nation. We are among top 5 nations in the world in terms of GDP. I have a third vision. India must stand up to the world, because I believe that unless India stands up to the world, no one will respect us. Only strength respects strength. We must be strong, not only as a military power, but also as an economic power. Both must go hand in hand. My good fortune was to have worked with three great minds. That is Dr. Vikram Sarabhai of the Department of Space, Professor Satish Dhawan, who succeeded him, and Dr. Brahm Prakash, father of nuclear material. I was lucky to have worked with all three of them closely and consider this the great opportunity of my life. I was in Hyderabad giving this lecture when a 14-year-old girl asked me for my autograph. I asked her what her goal in life is. She replied, I want to live in a developed India. For her, you and I will have to build this developed India. You must proclaim India is not an underdeveloped nation. It is a highly developed nation. You can say that our government is inefficient. You say that our laws are too old. You say that municipality does not pick up the garbage. You say that phones don't work, the railways are a joke, the airlines is the worst in the world, and the mails never reach their destination. You say that our country has been fed to the dogs and is in absolute pits. You say. What do you do about it? Dear Indians, I am echoing JF Kennedy's words to his fellow Americans to relate to Indians. Ask what we can do for India and do what has to be done to make India what America and other Western countries are today. Such an iconic speech, and the words are so strong. And yes, we have to live up to the vision and dream of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. Here in the pictures below, we can see Dalai Lama sitting with Abdul Kalam, and this is J.F. Kennedy, of whose words he just said when I read just now. Now, a little different about Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. I'll tell you short stories about him. Now, first thing is we can see him as a newspaper boy here when he was very small. You know, he helped his cousin in distributing newspapers, and it was then he got his first wages. All right. And, you know, there was during this Second World War, the trains, you know, in India, because our people were also helping them and supporting in the war. So our the allies, you know, we were with the allies of UK, USA and Russia during the Second World War. And our country was also helping them. So there had to be, you know, few adjustments to be done in our country itself. So the train did not stop during these days. The train did not stop at the station of Rameswaram. It used to go straight, crossed Rameswaram without stopping at the station and used to stop at Dhanushkodi. So the newspapers were thrown out from the train. So he was, Abdul Kalam helped his cousin who was a newspaper distributor and to collect the newspapers from the places where they had fallen and then to distribute it into the to the houses of the people so that people come to know about the latest news and about the Second World War. So this was, this picture you can see is of that. And we can see tamarind seeds here. You know, when the Second World War was going on, there was a demand for tamarind seeds because people, you know, they produce fuel using these tamarind seeds during the Second World War. It was in high demand. So APJ Abdul Kalam used to collect and sell the tamarind seeds to the provision shop located in the Mosque Street where his house was. He would earn a meager sum of 1 anna, which equals to 6 paise. All right. So this is a little about. I have a little more short stories of him, which I'll tell you now. Let us see what is written below. We can see him in this dress. What is that regarding to? Let us see. APJ, this A is missing here. APJ Abdul Kalam on Thursday became the first president to make a sortie in a supersonic fighter jet, fulfilling a childhood dream when he made a flight in a Su-30 MKI, multi-role combat aircraft from an airbase here. It was his dream to, be flying in this fighter jet. It was a dream of mine since 1958 when I became an engineer to fly in a fighter aircraft, Kalam said after 36 minutes flight, during which the frontline jet soared to a height of 25,000 feet or about 7.5 kilometer above the earth. So it was here he fulfilled his dream. All right. Now this is another story. This is his picture with his science teacher, Siva Subramanya Iyer. You know, Siva Subramanya Iyer, when he was teaching in the class, he noticed Kalam and what he said was, Kalam, I want you to develop so that you are on par with highly educated people of the big cities. And for this reason, you know, he became very close and used to call him to his own house and then to guide him how he had to go about. And he also invited him for lunch one day. But Siva Subramanya Iyer's wife was a very orthodox lady who refused to serve food to him on that day. But Siva Subramanya Iyer, his science teacher, himself served him food, and the wife, you know, she kept looking from behind the door and saw that there was absolutely no difference between a Muslim and a Brahmin person, and she regretted, you know, doing this. Next time she invited and she herself feeded this Abdul Kalam with her own hands here. And here we can see Siva on the first visit, Siva Subramanya Iyer was himself serving food. They had food together. And when, you know, he was going, Abdul Kalam was going, he blessed Siva Subramanya Iyer and told him that he should not be upset about what happened, because he said, once you decide to change the system, such problems have to be confronted. So these were the words, you know, and this definitely, you know, brought about a change in the thinking of Abdul Kalam and many people over there. And Abdul Kalam started visiting his house, and there was a change in the wife also because she started serving food. Now, here there's another story we can see. Here, children studying. He also talks about his friends. Abdul with his friends, he's studying here. I had three close friends in my childhood: Ramananda Sastri, Aravindan, and Siva Prakasan. All these boys were from Orthodox Hindu Brahmin families. So once in class 5, you know, when the teacher saw Abdul Kalam, who was a Muslim boy, sitting with the Brahmin children in the first row, he was told to get up and sit at the last row because Muslims during that time came in the lowest rank. But later on, the teacher was scolded by the people, by Lakshmana Shastri, who was the Pandit of the Rameswaram temple there, high priest he was, and he was scolded, and he was told either to apologize to the children or to leave Rameswaram, and the teacher apologized for his mistake and regretted also for having done so. In the next picture, we can see Abdul Kalam sitting there, and he says that while my friends practiced skimming pebbles over the rippling water, I would sit and watch the cranes and the seagulls soar in the sky. The sight of those birds inspired me, and I dreamed of my future, because at looking at the flying birds and the seagulls, he thought of the planes and all that he designed later on. Let us see. Here, Abdul Kalam at the MIT campus. Let us see. I studied hard to win a scholarship to study at such a well-known college. People, you know, with great difficulty used to get admission here. On the day I entered MIT, I saw my goal standing before me. The MIT campus boasted two large aircrafts on display. I remembering sitting near them long after other students had gone back to the hostel. I was fascinated by the details of the design and wanted to someday create such an aircraft. All right, and then we can see how he has actually designed. For my final project at MIT, I was asked to design a fighter jet with a team of 4 other classmates. We distributed the work among us, and all of them together designed this. And they were given, first design was not approved by the professor, and Abdul Kalam was very disappointed. So Abdul Kalam went and wanted 1 month more to design the way he had actually wanted. The teacher gave him 3 days, and he was able to do an impossible task of designing this this plane jet within 3 days, and for which he was really acknowledged for in his own MIT college. He is also known as the Missile Man of India. We all know, under the leadership of Abdul Kalam, the project of IGMDP proved to be successful by producing missiles like the first Prithvi missile in 1988 and then Agni missile in 1989. Due to his contribution, he was known as Missile Man of India. In 1992, he was appointed as the scientific advisor to the defense minister. Now, here I have a screenshot, he's known as one of the pillars of BrahMos. Let us see. Dr. Avul Pakir Janulabdin Abdul Kalam, a specialist in aeronautical engineering and one of the most distinguished scientists of India, has made significant contributions to the Indian space research programs with the evolution of the country's first indigenous satellite launch vehicle, that is SLV-3. He was the project director of India's first satellite, Rohini. During his tenure in the DRDO, he headed the Integrated Guided Missile Development Program. All right, this is what I wrote on the top, IGMDP. All right. To develop 5 different missiles, that is Prithvi, Agni, Trishul, Akash and Nag. He was responsible for the development and operationalization of Agni and Prithvi missiles and for building indigenous capability in critical technologies through networking of multiple institutions. As the scientific advisor to the Defense Minister and the Secretary for the Department of Defense Research and Development, that is DRDO, Dr. Kalam envisioned the concept of joint partnership, which led to the formation of BrahMos Aerospace between India and Russia. A great, great achievement for our country. We all know about Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam's autobiography. The name is Wings of Fire. What is an autobiography? When a person writes his own life story, everything about himself and what all he has done. There's this famous quotation of his, which we all should know and we all have also read it. If you want to shine like a sun, first burn like a sun. That is, if you want to see yourself on the top, you have to struggle. Here are a few. You know, there are many, many quotations of his. Go through the internet, Google it. You will find so many stories about his childhood, about his life, what all he did, and so many quotations which actually we should adhere to. Let us read all these three. All birds find shelter during a rain, but eagle avoids rain by flying above the clouds. So do something different. Why be a follower? Be your mentor. Change the route and go somewhere else and achieve something different, just like he did. Then he also says, if you fail, never give up, because fail means first attempt in learning. So see through it and go through it and succeed. All birds find shelter. This is the same thing that I have repeated, I think. There's a line which added, which I actually added. But eagles avoid rain by flying above the clouds. Problems are common, but attitude makes the difference. So be the difference, make the difference that you want to see in life. That's all for today. I hope you really liked it. Take inspiration from him. We'll meet next Wednesday with another Wow episode. Do take good care of yourself. If you are a newcomer, please subscribe my channel. Press the bell icon for the latest notifications. Do take good care of yourself. Bye-bye.